Welcome. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. I'm Tanya Fitzpatrick.
And I'm Ian Fitzpatrick, and this is World Footprints.
You know, we've been doing this series for a while about the impact of COVID-19 in communities around the world. And today, we're going to talk to a friend and colleague who is joining us from Mexico.
Tim Leffel is an award-winning travel writer, editor, and published author. He publishes multiple blogs and online magazines, including Perceptive Travel, an online magazine for independent travelers. Tim splits his time between the continental United States and Mexico, and it is from Mexico where he joins us today. Tim, first, how are you?
Doing well. Thanks for having me on.
And where are you precisely?
I'm in a city called Guanajuato. It's an old Spanish colonial city. It's actually a UNESCO World Heritage Site, kind of smack in the middle of the country up in the mountains. We're at 6,500 feet. A lot of interesting old architecture. And for Mexican people, this is a very important city because it was where the first battle of the revolution against Spain was.
And so how far from Mexico City? Because that's a lot of people's landmark.
Right. We're about 4 hours north of there. If you're in your own car, it takes a little longer on a bus, of course. But it's close enough that sometimes I fly out of there for international flights just because there are more options.
Mm-hmm. So I want to ask you about Mexico's response to COVID-19. My understanding is that they were a little bit slow to respond to this virus. Is that true?
Yeah, there have been a lot of parallels with how the United States has handled it, actually. The mayors and some of the governors were ahead of the curve and were pretty on the case about it. But the president was not and was basically still out hugging people and having rallies and things like that, even while it was erupting badly in the United States. And you knew it was just a matter of time here. So, you know, there wasn't much leadership from the top, unfortunately. I think otherwise we're probably in the same boat down here as far as there's not enough supplies, not enough ventilators, all that kind of thing you've been hearing about in the U.S. That probably was preventable to some extent. But they have made up for lost time in a lot of cases. But in Mexico City, it's especially bad just because it's a very dense urban area and you've got people living in close proximity. But here, I feel like for at least a month, people have been taking it pretty seriously where I live. And there's actually been police riding around with a megaphone telling people to break up and go home.
Mm-hmm. So you don't have any stay-at-home orders in your town?
Well, yeah, we do. And I think the bars and restaurants closed about a month ago. That's why I'm sort of using that as my landmark. But yeah, the essential services are open, grocery stores and pharmacies and things like that. There's a little cheating going on. There's some stores that shouldn't be open that are, and people are still gathering more than they should be. But I think for the most part, yeah, there's been a stay-at-home order, except for you can go out and exercise and whatever, but just you're supposed to be 6 feet away from everybody, and that's not always happening.
Tim, you kind of touched on it earlier that Mexico's having similar issues that we're seeing in the States, but what's happening specifically with PPE, the personal protective equipment, and testing in your area?
Yeah, they've been ordering PPE equipment like crazy from wherever they can get it from. But of course, you know, there's a world fight for this stuff, really. I don't know how else to put it, but they're getting what they can. And I mean, Mexico is one of those countries that has sort of a two-tier medical system. There's a universal health care, you know, for the basics, but then if you want more, you can pay for it. And so some of the private hospitals are in much better shape than the government ones are because they took the initiative to order supplies much further ahead. The testing is a whole different story. I don't believe the numbers at all in terms of how many cases there really are because it's too difficult for people to get a test. The same way it was, you know, maybe a month or 6 weeks ago in the United States where they just plain weren't around. And you had to have pretty bad symptoms before you would get tested. There's a lot of that going on here.
So with respect to the testing in your area, how is that conducted? Would it be through public health authorities, hospitals, doctors? What is it like in Mexico?
Yeah, from what I understand, mainly at the hospitals, there's no mass testing going on that I know about. It's mostly if you have the symptoms, you go in and you get checked out. But otherwise, there's not enough of them to be doing large-scale testing, which is sad because I know a lot of people would gladly go get the test, you know, to get some peace of mind, but it's just not available.
What has the death toll been like in Mexico? I mean, what are the numbers like?
Yeah, it's over 500 at this point, which doesn't sound like a lot compared to the U.S., but I think we're about 2 weeks behind on the, you know, on the curve. And again, it could be higher. You know, I think you run into that in a lot of countries where they're underreporting because they're calling it a lung disease or something, you know, like instead of calling it for what it is, like, but, or the person's not even tested and they don't know, you know, what's really happened to them. So I would imagine it's much higher than they're saying it is, but, you know, who knows where the peak is, you know, it could be another month from now, it could be 2 weeks from now, I don't know, but I don't feel like anybody has a solid grasp on what the real numbers are. I think in my state there's only been 8 or 10 maybe in the whole state, which is pretty good, but again, there will probably be many more.
Sure.
Shifting gears a bit, what sorts of creative things are you doing to cope with your new normal?
Well, we've been doing a lot of virtual happy hours with old friends and colleagues, trying to at least have some social interaction in our life. I think that's the main thing that's hard for people in this lockdown is you don't actually get to go out and talk to anyone anymore face to face. So we're trying to do more of that virtually. And we're doing a lot of cooking at home, of course, more of that than we ever did before. I'm sure a lot of people are saying that. And so trying to make some ethnic dishes every once in a while, at least take our taste buds on a trip. But trying to watch a bit of TV that will get me out into the world. I've been watching the Night on Earth documentary, and there's one that Walter Herzog did about volcanoes around the world. I've been trying to mix a little of that kind of thing in with the usual dramas and comedies.
Just to keep those distractions going.
Yeah, yeah. And reading, of course. I'm trying to, you know, do more reading than I did before and use the time wisely. And that can always transport you to another place.
Mm-hmm. So, Tim, I want to ask you because, you know, we've seen so many examples of how communities have rallied together, how people are helping their neighbors and supporting frontliners, et cetera. What things have you seen in your community? What acts of kindness and support have you witnessed?
Well, a lot of, we don't have loads of expats here. I'd say there's probably 300 or 400 maybe, but a lot of them were already involved in community organizations that help the less fortunate, and they've really stepped up their efforts in terms of, you know, food collection and money donations and things like that. It's just hard here to get a handle on things because there's such an underground economy and so many people that run taco stands or ice cream stands or, you know, work as a house cleaner or whatever, and they're just plain out of work right now. I think people have been trying to support businesses too by, you know, ordering takeout food and things like that, whatever they can to try to help businesses get through it. But it's difficult. I mean, there's such a diverse economy of solopreneurs, you know, and family businesses here that it's really difficult to do but so much.
When this pandemic passes, what's the first thing that you'll do or the first place that you'll go?
I think like a lot of people probably go out to a restaurant is high on the list, and then you know, get a haircut, those kinds of things. My wife is ready to get a massage because she has some back issues anyway. So for her, it's partly for pleasure, but partly to keep everything in the right place. And I know she's itching to do that again. The travel feels like it's further out. I think first it will be nice just to you know, be a normal person again and be able to go out and socialize and go have a meal that someone else cooks and they clean the dishes.
I agree, Tim. Well, thank you so much for joining us today and sharing what's happening in Mexico. And be safe, be well, and to everyone else out there, don't forget to smile.
Sounds good.